Welcome to episode 7 of Simple Ken. This is the home edition. My guest with me, who is Naveen Richard.
Hi.
Naveen Richard is my flatmate. And don't think, Naveen, that it took a lockdown for me to call you.
I was
you.
Thinking that this morning. I was like, oh, okay. Is it in terms of priority, I'm number 7?
No.
Or it could have been 10 also. It's very convenient that I happen to be here. Not that I happen to be a great conversationalist.
Who said you're an amazing conversationalist?
No, I'm a good conservationist. I've saved a squirrel when I was a child.
You have?
Yeah, I saved a squirrel, but the crow ate it finally.
I didn't know this, dude.
Yeah, it was a squirrel. Baby squirrel. It fell down. Hind legs were kind of screwed. So we took care of it. We made a little wheelchair for it. And then finally we had to go to Kerala for vacation.
How old were you?
It was me. I can't remember age, so yeah. I was this big.
Okay.
And then my cousin was 2 years older, my brother. And for like 2 weeks, we took care of the baby squirrel.
No.
And then finally, when we had to go to Kerala, here's the reveal. We left it because the mother squirrel was calling for it every day.
Yeah.
And we were like, listen, mother squirrel, we know you want a baby, but it's not ready. It can't walk yet. But finally, we had to go to Kerala. So we thought, okay, let's put it on the ledge.
Yeah.
And we went to Kerala, came back 2 weeks later, and our maid was like, oh, as soon as you put it on, crow came and took it, dude.
That's the thing, like maids are so brutal because yeah. They have seen life.
Yeah, dude.
So they're just like, oh, your stupid attempt at saving shit is... I think our housewife, when she saw us putting these bird stuff, she was just like, why do you leave food for animals?
Who was saying?
Even Alka.
Yeah.
Alka was like, why?
Were you wasting it?
Yeah, she laughed at me.
Yeah, why are you wasting money on bird food?
When some kids could have benefited from food.
There's no justification. We like seeing the sparrows come and eat it. We also do it with other kinds of charity, so it's not like.
Anyway, so the paranoia of corona. By the way, Naveen Richard made a song about coronavirus.
Yeah, man, this was before we realized how crazy shit's gonna get. I knew shit's gonna get crazy, so I was like, let's do it before.
Yeah. So kind of can I play it in the podcast?
Yeah, man. Play it. It's gonna be kind of catchy and annoying. But yeah, play it. Touch your eyes and mouth. Corona. Sitting in a crowded place. Corona. Shake a stranger's hand. Corona. Travel to a foreign land. Corona. Not as bad as AIDS. Corona. Still much worse than SARS. Corona. Started in Wuhan. Corona. Now it's on your hand. Yesterday, I think when people were banging the plates, there were people playing the song.
Oh,
banging
wow.
The plates along with it.
What is your opinion on banging of plates?
I mean, it's fun and all. Yeah, it's fun, dude. But like, bro, don't go out. I've seen some videos of people losing their shit.
Yeah.
And I mean, of course, it's morale boosting.
To be fair, I am the more cynical of both of us. And Naveen was being very positive. He was doing it for the right reason. He was doing it because, you know, we need to let people feel like we're together.
I took out my pan because I'm like, there's no sense of rhythm going on in the street.
That's
and
true.
I need to bring in some sort of like, tang, 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 tang. And then I saw videos of the way people were losing their shit. And I'm like, wow, this is not about the healthcare workers at all.
Yeah.
This is really about them getting an excuse to do whatever the fuck they want. And then I was like, no, we lost the plot, which I'm surprised people didn't. We lost the plot before we banged the place itself. The kind of messages I was getting, like, this is going to chase away the virus. This is this and that. I was like, this is about the healthcare workers, apparently. They didn't hear it. They were inside their hospitals, not able to hear the banging. So really, this just became about people themselves.
Sorry, I went down to adjust the mic level because everything is being done by us. So, sorry if I went off frame. But yeah, that's the thing. I knew that anything people come up with, they'll find some weird ass justification that coronavirus can go away by frequencies. And imagine healthcare workers, like, you came in a group to cheer us when you have increased our job.
Yeah, but I'll give credit where it's due. Yeah. The police are out really making sure that shit's closed. I went to buy some fruits today.
Yeah.
And I heard like a siren. Like, I'm like, holy shit, what is this? This cops like yelling at people to close it down. And that way, I think we seem to be taking it seriously. Yeah. I mean, people, you can't control people's minds, but at least the police are doing their job. And I've been seeing some crazy videos of 9 cops beating up people who come up.
Nice.
Bam, bam.
You know, it's tough being a cop, man, because there are like few who are great.
Yeah.
And there are majority of them who are shit. And the few people are doing good job, like they'll never be celebrated.
Yeah, yeah. No, they
like the same cop who's hitting people who are going out. Mm. Must also hit other people for other reasons.
Maybe just taking any excuse to hit.
Yeah, man. It's fun though. It's fun to hit. If I was a cop, I would slap all college kids just for existing. What is that shirt?
Yeah, dude, it can go to your head.
You know, I see a certain college guy with a certain haircut. I just want to smack him. Is this just me?
No. There are some slappable faces.
Yeah, no.
We're not propagating or encouraging slapping. But I'm just saying.
I am.
There's an inherent need in you. Sometimes you see a face and you're like, it's a very slappable face. Now, does that come from your personality or were you just born with this face? Only science can tell.
Some uncles who yell at their children and they're like, he has one slappable face, and you want to agree with that uncle.
Yeah.
I remember that uncle story where you were in Bangalore and then you guys got arrested. I mean, they called the cops on you for making noise.
Cops, yeah.
And then one of the uncles was like, no, I heard him saying motherfucker.
Yeah.
And everyone got awkward.
Me and one of my roommates back then, we would get into huge arguments about the content we would make.
Yeah.
Just simply based on the concept, our sketch, them boxer shots, we'd be like, no, it should be like this. And in the middle of the afternoon, full blown yelling from my friend, from Money, in fact, Money from Starboys, in fact.
Starboys.
He would yell like, fuck it, I don't give a fuck, motherfucking shit, motherfucking that, and motherfucking this. And
just to the uncle. Oh, no, at home.
To me. Yeah. But now, it's a Sunday, dude. People can hear.
Yeah.
So then the next day, the uncle came and he rounded up Arvind and me. Arvind is the other box shots guy. And all the uncles gathered up because they're like, we're going to bust these bachelor boys, right?
Yeah.
And he's like, you think we don't know? We heard all the words. They're saying motherfucker and all. And we were like, oh, uncle, why are you saying that? He's like, you think we don't know what's motherfucker? We know motherfucker. We know what it means, this motherfucker. And all the other uncles like, bro, you're losing the plot here again. Yeah. And we're like, uncle, your kids are insane. They're going to hear you now. You're saying it more than us.
Dude, I love it when old people say words which are weird. I think the first time I saw an adult saying fucker, it freaked me out.
Yeah.
I was like, wait, you are a bad example for your children.
Yeah. Have you ever heard your dad curse?
No, man.
You know how your dad cursed?
My dad said, he said fucker once.
Really?
And he said it, I think, to look cool in front of me. So it didn't count.
So did he pull it off?
No. He said, he's a fucker.
And, well, I mean, how old were you when he heard it?
Yeah, like it happened 2 years ago.
Oh, so you were old enough.
Yeah.
I heard my dad say shit or fuck or something when I was in 6th, 7th
standard. Bastard and all, he said.
And like, of course, he was pissed and he was saying it to some other people. And I was like, does it mean I can say it?
Yeah.
Like, I remember when I was in 9th or 10th standard, I said bloody. Okay. Yeah. I was talking to a teacher. I think I said the word bloody. My bad.
Yeah, bloody was a very bad
11th standard. He's like, this is how you talk in your house. You can say bloody and all. I'm like, yeah, uncle, we say bloody and all. Is it really bad? So kneel down outside, write an apology letter for saying bloody. And in my letter, I was like, actually, we do say it at home, but I guess he's offended by it. So I will not take responsibility for my parents, blah, blah. You know, sometimes your friend will get hit by a teacher and he'd be like, my own father has not hit me. And he'd be like, hey,
yeah,
hello.
These what kids, is this house? They grow up with no humility and no direction in life. I know it just sounds like we're pro-hitting our kids. I would not hit my kids too much. I would want them to know that you can't fuck with me. Which if it involves a little slap.
Yeah.
Okay, you know what? I don't know, man. I don't want to hit them. But they need to know who's boss. Because I've seen fucking rich kids.
There's a huge set in my special about this.
Yeah? Which is out, by the way. Naveen Richard's special.
Yes, it is.
Relatively relatable.
Yeah.
Is out on Amazon Prime Video.
Twister. Yeah, so I talk about how there should be some NGO, which is all NGOs are like, hey, we have to make poor people feel good. But I think there should be an NGO that makes rich kids feel like shit. And you got to hit it by hitting them, you know, because they're always complaining. Like, I've been in Himachal and all, and I've seen these cute little kids playing on the freaking road with twigs, and they're the happiest little cute little fuckers I've ever seen.
Yeah.
And then rich kids in there who have everything are like, yeah, I want iPhone Plus Pro. Fucking fatak. Oh, okay, fine. Chalkboard is enough, you know. Just...
So, chalkboard. So one girl asked this question, Anvita Shetty. She didn't frame it very clearly, but this is the same topic. She said, is there any such thing that middle class people should not do friendship with rich people? Because I've seen rich people bossing around all the time and have really high standards, but they are as good as a person and makes me feel uncomfortable to speak to them, as they say you have a lot of attitude and all this is kind of suffocating. I think what she's primarily saying, that when a middle class person and rich people become friends, it gets a little complicated. And
yeah,
I think it's always good for both parties. I think being friends with some rich people has shown me how toxic it is to be rich.
Yeah.
But it's also shown me how to not to enjoy life, to not put every value on money. And I think rich people should see middle class people and get some humility.
Yeah, there are more down to earth. You know, when you're growing up, you have the more down to earth rich friends, and then there's the I mean, do you remember when you first realized, or did you ever have a realization where you're like, oh, wait, there's this other experience that rich people have that I... Do you remember any such moment?
Yeah, so Jason, who's my best friend.
Yeah.
That motherfucker, dude. Yeah. I didn't know what a PlayStation was.
Yeah.
And I went to his house and he switched on the TV and the graphics was 3D. And this was when we had cassettes where you blow on it.
PS1, huh? Yeah.
He had PS1. And then I was just blown away. And then the next week, he had an iPod. He was one of the first. He had the black and white iPod.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I was like, what is this MP3 thing? And that's when I realized, like, oh, that poor.
Yeah, relatively.
Yeah.
He
was very, very upper middle class rich guy.
Yeah, until then, you don't realize you want these things and classic stuff like that. Because that cassette video game thing was kind of binding. I remember first my cousins had it and we didn't have it. And slowly, almost everybody had one in their house or someone, you know, the cassette one.
Yeah.
So that was kind of not like only rich people had it. I think almost everybody had that cassette thing, right?
Yeah.
The cassette 100 games in one.
For $300 or something.
It was cheap enough, the Nintendos.
Yeah.
But I think... I
didn't have Nintendo. I had some random brand.
Some random shit on
you. Yeah.
But I think I first realized it and it really stung me. First time is when my friends would talk about flying. They'd be like, you know, Jet Airways has better food. And I'm like, 600, much. I've not even gotten in a flight. You can compare food in different flights. No,
yeah.
Right? And then another time, I was in my best friend's house. Again, my best friend, right? And till then, my dad would take us out to Dosa Kada, which is in Tamil Nadu. We have like Dosa Kada. It's like a small little joint my father's been going to since he was a kid. Go there and have dosas from the same akka who's been making dosas since he was a kid. And we were happy, right? And then one day, my best friend, he was like, Macha, you know residency, right? We were going to residency and stuff in Coimbatore, which is the only 5-star place in Coimbatore. I was like, what's residency? He's like, dude, residency. You know that Chin Chin in residency, the Chinese restaurant? And I'm like, what's that? And he was like, Mom, he doesn't know what residency is. I'm like, what's residency? Mom, he hasn't been to residency? I'm like, then I went home and I asked my mom, I said, what is residency? Why haven't we gone there? And my whole family felt bad. My dad's like, one day I'll take you guys to a Chinese restaurant every week. From now. I feel so bad. And I just like, what is this concept that I'm supposed to apparently know?
Dude, like,
I think it sticks with you, man. These things stick with you.
I had the reverse experience because I went to Kendra Vidyalaya. And Kendra Vidyalaya, like, uniform is such a good idea.
Yeah.
Kids don't realize that your friend could not have money or have a lot of money. The uniform is a unifying thing. And one day I went to my friend's, this guy used to always share his lunchbox with me.
Yeah.
I went to his house, dude. His entire house is one room.
Oh, okay.
It was a living room, the kitchen. And in the corner, they used to flip the table and that became the bed.
Yeah.
And this guy was like a topper in my class.
Yeah.
And I remember when I went home, the whole family greeted me and we had dinner together. And I've been to rich people's houses where I've gone in and the mother and father didn't even know I was home.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, they never offered us any food or anything. They just like, you let the kids play.
You just go upstairs and upstairs. The parents are downstairs.
Yeah, and that was just like, man.
I'm sure there's so many rich kids feeling so guilty watching this.
Yeah, man, you should be.
Watching this and be like, which floor of the house am I on right now?
Yeah. I mean, all technically, we are also upper middle class rich.
Yeah, yeah, we were. Yeah,
but we've seen both sides.
We've seen both sides, but I know what she means. You know, that question is coming from a place of... it does fill you up with insecurities that might stick around for the rest of your life. And I think it's good to experience this richness and get over this fear.
Yeah.
It's a bit of a fear of basically, have you seen the world in a way? Like, yeah. How much experience? And I think when you're richer, you have more experiences in the other side of the spectrum.
Yeah.
So you come with more confidence, right?
Yeah.
And as you grow up, you're fine still you suddenly meet this person who seems to... And then it'll draw up those insecurities again in your life, no matter how old you are. So it's good to experience it, see what it's like, and then make up your mind to tell yourself, okay, I know what it's like and it's not throwing me off. And then be comfortable where you are again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Parikshit, I love it when a guy has the word shit in his name. What a wonderful life he would have had in school. Mm-hmm. His name is Parikshit, dude. Oh, it's so easy to bully him. Hey, Kenny, I'm 22. And everyone around me is now like, this is your youthful days, do something fun. You should enjoy more, party more. And it's like, there's peer pressure to even have fun, whether the definition of fun is not the same for everyone. But then I think about it and then I get scared that what if in my 40s, I regret not doing anything fun. I don't know how to think about this. This is a great question because personally, I was in this phase when I was 25, 26, where I was like, I don't know how to have fun because I thought having fun means going out, drinking and chilling. And then thankfully to having friends who are above 30,
they normalize
like you can just be at home or you can just go to a restaurant and hang out with your friends. And I thought it was weird to do that.
Yeah.
And I think Parikshit, your definition of fun is different from someone else's definition of fun. And you will regret. I think no one regrets. I think it's a better regret to be like, okay, I worked a little too much and be comfortable than being like, I had way too much fun and now I don't have a house. So it's all these rich people, all these documentaries, they have like, Taylor Swift has a documentary on Netflix called Miss Americana.
Yeah.
And she's like, you know, I got 2 Grammys back to back. Best Grammy of the year. But then I realized I don't have a partner. I don't have friends. I'm like, what a great problem to have now versus having a partner, having friends and not having a house and not having money. So
you can always say, you're saying take a break later.
Yeah. Like you don't have to work all your life and you don't have to chill all your life. Just like, obviously balance is so hard. I'm like, I think the 20s you hustle, the rest of your life is sorted.
I mean, this guy hasn't said anything about, I work hard.
He sounds very guilty to have fun.
Yeah. If he's feeling guilty, or is he a kind of guy who's comfortable not doing anything? And because if he forces himself to go out and party, like I remember going to a club and I was always excited about my first time going to a club in Bangalore and I hated it.
How old were you? 19.
Club about 18 or something.
Yeah.
And then I hated it. So once a year I'd go to a club just to remind myself how much I hated going to clubs.
Man.
So that was one. And I'm like, a lot of people seem to want that. And to me, that seemed like an illusion. Even now when I go into a club, I'm like, are you guys lying to yourselves or what? Why are you guys pretending to have fun? Come on, this is not fun. Just stop lying to yourselves. Is this really fun? Because how can this be fucking fun? Just stop pretending.
But I've met people who genuinely love it.
That's the thing. So I had a lot more fun when I was 20. I think we can only say what we did when we were 21, 22.
We both have big exceptions because we hate what most people like. And we
chilled a lot. I wasted a lot of time. See, I think it's important to waste some time in life. And I don't regret the amount of time. I mean, if I'd worked harder, would I be even further? I don't know, but I don't regret the time I wasted. Because I think that shapes you as well.
True.
I mean, I wasted a lot of time. We were the kind of my boxer shorts house in the friends who we lived with.
Just to give you context, Naveen's group, them boxer shorts, used to have a house in Bangalore, which is a 3-floor house.
Yeah.
And there were 5 guys in it.
At any given time.
Average.
Yeah.
And that house was the most chillest place. It's great to chill in. I don't know how you got any work done.
Yeah, it was kind
of
crazy.
Naveen was the dad of that house.
You've been there. You've been to that house.
By the way, we washed our hands. That's why we were touching our face. A lot of comments are like, don't touch your face. We washed our hands. So,
Where was I? Yeah, so in those houses, I think when I was 21, 22, I did waste a lot of time. Although I did feel guilty. I think if you have a drive inside you, you can't help but work. So you are going to end up working.
Yeah, you know, so people who are having fun don't ask questions like this.
They don't have
and people who
questions.
Work, also, like it's very obvious what kind of person you are by the questions you ask.
Yeah.
So it's very obvious.
So you seem like you're fine. If you're fine chilling by yourself, but just don't feel guilty wasting time. And also, I recommend this. I recommend don't be afraid to do some dumb shit in life.
Yeah.
I mean, hopefully you're lucky enough to get out of it unscathed. But I have
now he's done some cool dumb shit. Like dumb shit that's really cool. Like you went to Australia and you stayed by yourself for 10 days.
Yes.
This is a guy who's never been to Australia before and he's camping alone. And you camped in a tent and around wild animals. Like, it's pretty cool. I would have never done that shit because I need things to be in
control.
Yeah,
I was happy by myself, actually. I was waiting. I went for the comedy festival, but all I could think of was the camping that came after. So I just rented a car. I took a tent and I didn't... The thing is... I think the reason I get into stupid shit is also because I don't plan too much.
No, but you get into like good stupid shit. Like this is like good story to tell.
Like I think the craziest story is when I went, I was tired of all the regular hiking routes because there were too many people there. So then I was like, I need some difficult hiking route. So then I found out there's this mountain called Mount Difficult because that's the most difficult trek there is.
Yeah.
And you're supposed to start hiking at 10 a.m. so that you can get back before sunset. I start driving towards there in the middle of nowhere. It's Australia. I told you about that stone that got stuck inside my tire.
Yeah.
So now I had to stop. And then I was delayed by 2 hours trying to fix this, find the stone. So now my whole trek is delayed. I go up the mountain and everyone's coming back down when I'm going up. And then I get lost on the way back down and I can't find my way. And I'm like, whoa, am I going to spend the night here? And in my head, I'm like preparing. All right.
Wait, so you spend the night halfway down the mountain?
No, I was still stuck somewhere on top because I got lost somewhere near the top itself because it's very tiny.
This is in Australia.
In Australia. And I was like, should I call a rescue helicopter now or what? So there was one point, you know, when you're really scared, when I did this because I really looked around and I couldn't see anyone. I couldn't find the path. And I stood on top of one cliff and I was like, help? No, not help. I was like, hello? This is stupid. Hello? All right, it's not coming. 5 minutes later, well, I'm like, maybe. Hello? Okay, fuck, I might die.
Isn't that the great thing about being in India?
Yeah.
In India, that would not happen. Because there will be some fucker on that hill, dude.
There's going to be some fucker
on some hill. But in Australia and abroad, if you're alone, man, you're alone. Like, you will bleed out to death. Like, if your car... breaks down, very few people go by.
A few people were going by. Luckily, it was tourist season.
But how did you get out of the situation? I just realized we would have gone to the next question and you wouldn't have ended the story. How did you escape?
Unfortunate enough, I just kind of... when you get lost in the path, you just go back to the point that you last recognize. You just keep going back. Don't keep going further down that lost path. If you've followed a hike, just go back.
It's a beautiful
stand, and
nice.
And then follow a path. This is not the right path. You don't recognize it. Come back and just keep.
There's no shame in coming back.
Eventually, I found the way down, man. That was excruciating. So, yeah, man, basically, don't be afraid to do some stupid shit because that's the kind of shit you're going to remember. And also, it's only when things go wrong that anything memorable ever happens. So, I wouldn't have a story to tell you if I didn't fuck up that day. So, don't be afraid when things go wrong because those are the memorable moments.
KP has a question. This question I took, again, this excited me, this topic. I'm pretty sure you have been offered with character roles in Bollywood, like most of your colleagues. Are you just waiting for the right story or is it just that you want to focus on what you like to do and to be the best in it? So I have done a couple of auditions for really lame roles.
I did the same audition that you did.
Yeah. And this is, I wanted to bring up Bollywood because Naveen has very strong opinions about Bollywood. I mean, my opinion is just that I have no hope in it or no faith in it. Not the mainstream one. There are some side movies like Article 15.
There'll be people who defend and be like, what about this? What about this? What about this?
Yeah, but no one's watching that anyway. So there's no argument. Like Tumbad and all, freaking nobody saw that movie. But yeah, so Naveen, what is your... you want to be an actor. You've done a lot of acting roles. What is your...
They don't have attention to fucking detail, Kenny. They don't have attention to detail. And... it's fine. You can make a fucking massy film. I'm not just talking about Bollywood. Even some Tamil cinemas, once they go big scale, I'm like, just pay some attention to the people in the fucking background.
This is a great thing that Naveen does. Whenever we watch a movie, Naveen will pause the frame and look at the guy in the back. And it's so cool because the guy in the back is doing some shit. Or when there's a teacher doing a role and the students, one of the students looks like a 50-year-old man in a college pretending to be a 18-year-old kid. So now it's really fun.
No, man. I mean, it's not impossible to do. You can't be like, oh, we don't have the facilities. This is India, dude. Give us a break. I'm like, no, fucking watch a good cinema. Like, even I was watching Queen the other day. And I'm like, man, every extra is doing a good job.
Yeah.
So it's not impossible. It's just about spending a little extra time.
I mean, what made you see Queen the other day?
I don't know why. I was just like, okay, let's... Because you know how much I shit on films?
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm going to watch this film.
Have you not seen Queen?
No, I haven't seen
it. Queen is awesome, dude.
Yeah. So I watched like half an hour of it. Because that itself was BTM late for me to...
Great opening, the wedding scene.
Yeah. And you know, there was that wedding scene where everyone's at the wedding. I mean, the engagement or whatever. And I was like, wow, everyone's doing a great job. Yeah. I'm like, so this is possible. Yeah. I watched some Malu films. And over there, like Kumbhalanganai, I was watching it for the third time yesterday just to look at the attention to detail. Yeah. That's what happens when you fucking care about your film. Now, the director will be like, oh, you think we don't care about our fuck film? It's very good. Grand, look at the... I'm like, fucker, to pay a little attention to the fucking things hanging off the goddamn top. Fucking cast the right guy for the goddamn... not even like the background extra, dude. You know how the waiter comes? Fucking cast a good waiter, dude. There's some fucker actor who will maybe pay him 3,000 bucks extra. You'll get an actor who's fucking believable. I'm not saying that in some of the shows that we've done, we haven't had some bad extras. So I know that it's difficult, but it's not impossible. You have the fucking resources.
I want people who are listening to the show right now, if anyone, a good Samaritan writer, you have a lot of primary hands, can compile scenes of waiters in Hindi movies. And you can tag me and Naveen. We would share it with your name. So scenes of waiters or extras in Hindi movies and Hindi TV shows doing the worst job.
We've done it. I mean, there's been shows that I've been in itself where the waiters aren't right. And I know that it's, and I've been hard on ourselves, but I've seen it done right.
Yeah.
In a Malu film industry, well, the fucking budgets are much lesser. They're only like so 4 crores.
It's not a budget problem.
It's not a budget. It's about the fucking person caring, dude.
You know, Naveen is pissed when the level of fucking has gone very high. When there's a fuck every 3 seconds, it's a fucking problem.
You know what? I'm not going to be a critic. Maybe one day I'll make the fucking film. Then the director will be like, make the film and show how can
no,
you can
no,
make
No, I think you would.
Light.
No, it's reflected in your work. I think it's not that hard to look at everything in a frame and be like, okay, that's a problem, that's a problem, that's a problem.
Someone's noticed it. Yeah. Someone, at least the assistant, then tell the director. Now, the director must be like, we don't have time to focus on this shit. Spend extra time.
Are you talking about anyone in particular? Just saying generally.
I mean, you remember that there was one Rajnikanth movie where the guy was... He was hammering something, but he wasn't even touching the thing.
Yeah.
There was a shot of this huge dam, and you can see the fucking thermocol dam. I'm like, you could have cut no one fucking 20 seconds before that, before he cut to the thermocol dam. Nobody notices.
Thermocol dam.
It's about the storyline. God, you know? Anyway, man.
That's I'm so glad. I'm so right that Naveen would get worked up with this question. So basically, Bollywood, there's no... Yeah, we need a different approach. Care about... Zoya Akhtar takes a lot of attention.
Yeah, that's the thing. Yeah. It's not impossible. So
Farhan Akhtar does.
Maybe one day...
That family's our only hope.
Yeah, that's... There are people out there. Other people need to stop thinking they can get away with it. The problem is, of course, not just them. They're going to be like, audience doesn't care what we're But fucking, if you have some goddamn self-respect.
That's what Abhish was talking about. Art by community and art. What is that, dude? He'll kill me for this. One is individual person decides the whole art versus community. So films technically should be the individual person's vision.
Hmm.
It's like, I'm not making the movie for everyone, I'm making it for myself.
Yeah.
But my audience should like it. Art by community is like, this is what the audience wants.
Yeah.
And you can't have that because it's like a loop. Audience is like, we came to see it because nothing else to see. And filmmakers like, they're not seeing anything else, so we're making this only. Someone has to break it.
Grand spectacle films, Transformers and the Avengers and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And it's true. Those are lazy as well. Avengers, the way they frame... can be lazy. You see, Thor Ragnarok, not lazy.
Yeah.
So it's just about now. I'm not saying now every director is going to be as great as Taika Waititi and care
about
it.
But he was also forced to do a big spectacle ending.
Yeah, but because he was he'd done enough independent films. He knows how to care about casting the extras and making sure they have a sense of humor.
Yeah.
And maybe, hopefully, there's enough money left at the end of this corona outbreak to continue making movies so that we can make
if
our movies
one
day.
The world survives.
We're going to make movies one day. That's our plan as well. Yeah.
So LJ asks, I've noticed that nowadays I usually get annoyed when things get out of control. Most of the times it becomes difficult for me to decide whether to react on things or no, or if reacting, then how much to regulate myself. How to know if my reaction is right for a certain situation, or if I'm just overreacting. Is there a mantra, or is it just how you learn to understand yourself and deal with life? So this is also something we discuss a lot about. Are we overreacting? Are we underreacting? How much to let... What ruins your day? What doesn't ruin your day?
Yeah.
I think we both are on slightly opposite spectrum sometimes. I think you tend to underreact and I tend to overreact. And there are days where it flips where you... not any particular situation, not like today or something.
Oh, this morning? I was really hungry, dude, so I snapped at them anyway.
Yeah. No, I wasn't even talking about that.
Oh.
Just what's going on right now. But a few weeks ago, I was overreacting.
Yeah.
So I think this is like, LG, just you're not alone in this. It's literally, you're asking, how do people stay motivated? A lot of questions of how do you stay motivated? I start something, I stop doing it. I'm like, yeah, everyone is going through the same thing. It's not like any of us have figured it out. But it is such a conundrum to know if, did I overreact to this or did I underreact to this? And I think reference helps.
I mean, is he talking about situations in life?
Yeah.
Or is it to, is he talking about like, Twitter, someone says, and then you overreact, underreact, that sort of a thing?
No, I think when he says, when things get out of control.
Things get out of control.
I think he's talking about his own life. How I figure out is I collect sample size, like economics. I was like, okay, I'm going to this problem. I'm going to ask 5 people. Or I'm going to observe 5 people and see how they react in the situation. And that's the best I can do. Because technically everyone has their own rules. For some people, for example, exaggerated example, someone cheats on their partner and makes out with some other person. Literally 5 people will give you different answers. One person like, it's not even a discussion. It's over. Well, another person will be like, well, you know, were they drunk? Do they regret it? Are they sorry? Well, another person will be like, you know, I've made the same mistake, so it'll be hypocritical for me. So I'm just like, so I take the average of it and that's 50% and how I feel about it. And I take 50%. And
that's a good way of doing it because you can't force yourself. The moment you force yourself to feel something, it's going to come off as fake.
Yeah.
And you're going to fuck it up. You know, when you're like, I'm going to go in there pissed. I'm going to go in there pissed off and I'm going to yell. And then when you do it, no one buys it. First of all, you're like, this is weird. This doesn't seem natural. And no one's going to feel it because you're not feeling it. And you're going to be like, what is he thinking? So
also opposite is true. Where you fake convince yourself that you're okay with it. And you say, I'm okay with it. It's fine. And then 2 months later, you were never okay with it. And it comes out.
Yeah. But at that moment, if you're not bursting with emotion to overreact, then you're going to regret overreacting because you're like, wait, that didn't feel right.
Yeah.
So I think like you said, take your time. Because I think what you do is because you don't overreact when it happens.
Yeah.
That's why you have the time to collect the sample size.
Yeah, yeah. My first reaction is don't react. Give it a few days. Because the first reaction is always wrong.
Which is good. Then you're gifted with this thing of your emotions don't get the better of you immediately.
Most of the time.
And yeah, sometimes. Yeah. I mean, even today, you know, I don't get pissed. And today I was yelling at old people. So.
Oh, shit.
And but then that felt fine to me.
Yeah.
At that moment, I was sick and tired of the
bullshit.
But give
it tomorrow morning. Do you think you'll get up and be like, maybe I shouldn't have?
Maybe. But no, but at the same time, I didn't fake that. At that moment, I was feeling it. And I expressed. And later you can regret it. But this thing of him asking, again, like you said, he's asking the question of, am I supposed to overreact or underreact? Do what you're feeling at that moment.
Yeah.
Because if you tell yourself from now on, any moment that comes along my way, I'm going to overreact to be safe. You might first of all be faking it. Two, you might start reprogramming yourself and you're going to change yourself as a person. It's better to keep your emotions.
Also, 80% of the time, you can apologize if you overreacted. I think very few things are irreversible. So if you have a fight with a roommate and you have a yelling match, I think the next day, if you apologize, things will go back to normal most of the time. So I think most situations in life are not do or die. Very few situations are like, I reacted the wrong way and now there's no going back. I think at work sometimes when you negotiate salaries or promotions, if you mess that up, you're screwed.
Yeah, you have a calm mind, man.
Yeah, if you messed up a relationship with a boss, you can feel that consequence for the rest of your life. Maybe that also will change. Now, this is by Arjun PB. Arjun PB asks, when you...
Yeah, these are not supposed to be anonymous questions, right?
No. This is on YouTube. Okay. Usually not, they say, whenever I have an Instagram DM...
Okay, then that's a personal.
That's a personal question. So, when you or some other stand-up comedian say some jokes, I sometimes think that it's so obvious. Why didn't I think of it? Is there a method you follow to observe the quirks and characteristics of people or situations that come up with jokes? Or does it come naturally when you start writing a piece? The reason I picked this question up is the curse of making things look simple.
Yeah.
It's a curse. And this is something I'm learning this year, is to talk about how hard things are. Just a few days ago, someone commented on the video saying, good video, except the color grading is shitty.
Son of a bitch. After all the feedback I gave.
Yeah. And I responded saying, you pay for the color grading then. Because people don't realize that color grading is also a skill and it costs money. And we just present content like, here's the final product. There's another comment on my Royal Enfield video. They were like, someone said, Corona, careful, don't go outside. I said, I shot this 4 months ago. Someone said, if you shot this 4 months ago, why is it coming out now? And then I'm like, oh yeah, that's my fault, because you don't realize that there's editing, sound mixing, color correction, client has to give feedback, there's second round of editing, there's approvals, there's production money, there's crew. All of that takes time, but audience thinks that, man, you shot this, now shoot another thing. You did a show yesterday, why isn't it up on YouTube? And I think it's kind of the artist's responsibility to, and some say the audience doesn't need to know. I think they need to know in this day and age.
This is basically the excuse that any director will give for me shitting on there.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
We have come full circle.
I'm basically the troll that's like, wow, fix your extra.
Yeah.
Like, hello, you know what?
But you know, you're different. You're not an audience member. You're also a content creator.
Yeah.
So you know the process involved. Yeah. This is someone, Arjun PB is not a comedian.
No, but,
So he's like, man, why don't I think of it? But he's not making it sound like it's simple. He's like, it seems like it's very simple. If another comedian shits on another comedian, I'll be like, okay, I can take something out of it. But if a person who has no idea about the field...
Talking to a journalist yesterday about the special, and he was like, so you call it relatively relatable, and what's with all these relatable jokes? I mean, like, with the onslaught of Hindi, English, comedy, so many relatable jokes, and I could tell he is sick of it. So I was like, so I assume you like all this darker kind of comedy. He's like, I mean, that's just one of the things. So I'm like, I could tell he's sick of, he's like, won't people run out of relatable stuff? I'm like, no, man. The fun of doing observational comedy is pointing out something that was right in front of you the whole time.
Yeah.
And what's great is you're like, oh my God, I found this fucking thing. It was right in front of us the whole time, guys. And I found it. It's like,
that's literally any invention.
Yeah.
Why didn't we make a mixie before? Why didn't we make a washing machine before? It's right there.
Yeah, man. And that's what's fun.
Why even make a fan?
These observations are right in front of all comedians to find it. And will we ever run out? It's like Seinfeld said, no, you're never going to run out. You're always going to find some. There's a million more things to find out.
I had the privilege of watching Seinfeld live. Oh, you were with me.
Yeah.
Naveen and I, we were in New York. I had the privilege of watching my fucking God live.
Mm.
And when I saw his show, till then my perspective was, a lot of comics were telling me that, Kenny, you seem very sheltered, which is not even true if you know about my life.
Yeah.
You need to go out more, have more experiences. I won't name which comic this is, but this is a comic who's very famous for talking about life experiences.
Do I know?
Yeah, of course you know. And then I saw Seinfeld's show and I realized that he could be in quarantine for 25 years and he would release 25 specials every year. Because he would make a joke about, you know, when you're cleaning glass, it's, don't you notice that squeaky sound? Some joke he'll make on it. And that's when I realized that the genius is the interpretation, not the situation. Anyone can make a joke about the government being shitty, only a genius can make a joke about something that was in front of your eyes and you thought that wasn't funny.
Yeah.
And that's funny. That's where the skill
something that you take for granted.
Yeah.
Like I said, when shit goes wrong, when something huge goes wrong.
Very easy to be like, oh, isn't it hilarious of Corona? We are at home.
Corona plus 70 tags. Well, you know.
It's you know, make a song called My Name is Corona.
Yeah, that kind of obvious shit.
It's making fun.
It's right in front of your eyes.
It's a fun song, dude. That's why it's good.
I just wanted to annoy people with the song. That's my goal.
I sang it for a week straight.
And but then smaller observational relatable stuff like that, it's just fun, you know. Yeah. I'm like, you watch the rest of the special, there's weirder shit.
Man, your special is really cool.
Self-aware of
is it a spoiler, Xavier?
Nah, it's okay. People know. My cousin, you know, have you met him? You've met him. He's annoyed you a bunch of times.
Yeah.
So, Xavier is this cousin of mine. I used to spend my summer vacations in his house. And so, I still get guilt tripped by his mom. And we're like, support. Hey, give Xavier a spot. Give him an opportunity. And it's basically this family guilt trip.
So, Naveen does this thing where he plays characters in comedy. And when he's playing a character, he pretends like he's not Naveen anymore. Which is hilarious.
The fuck are you talking about? You've met him. Anyway. You met him, Kenny. There's a picture
of
my
Instagram. If I go to your cupboard right now, there's a wig that Xavier wears. Coincidence much?
No, that's for another role I did. Yes, I play characters. Uncle Francis character. Xavier. Why are you acting like you didn't fucking meet him, Kenny? Why are you doing this? Fucking acting.
Sure,
remember
man.
He wanted to audition for Comistan and it didn't get through?
Yeah,
he
was that one of the totally auditions. Didn't happen.
I don't know why the fuck he's acting like a
next question.
Douchebag dude right now.
Hey, your special is on Amazon Prime Video. Please watch it. It's freaking awesome. It's not like you have something else to do.
Yeah.
So, 8AZ2K.
Huh?
That's his username. No, it's not even A to Z. It's A.
I think that's his password. By mistake, he made it his fucking username, dude.
This is not even a question. It's great because what started happening is people are asking questions in the comments and other people are answering it. And it's great.
I love it.
At this point in your life, how do you know if someone genuinely wants to become your friend expecting nothing or if they're trying to climb up the ladder using you? One answer. 20 likes, okay? Good question. One guy, Mr. Bortificate says, just be boring, then you will know if they will stay or not.
Wow.
Solved it. That's
nice.
That's something even I have to learn because I have this insane need to entertain and be positive and engaging all the time.
Yeah.
And I get mortified of being boring and mortified of not being valuable or useful in a situation.
Like if you mean in real life?
Yeah, in real life.
Yeah. I mean, that's what's conversely benefited in your stand-up. That's why you're constantly able to think of that many jokes as well.
Yeah.
You know, because you're so energetic off stage. You're thinking of, well, when you hang out with Kenny, he's you know, your observations and shit are just as genius in real life.
Thanks, man.
It's just like his stand-up is only a small part. I think that's why you enjoy watching him talk as well. I think you're able to come up with observations like it's nothing. Like when Kenny does an impersonation of another comedian, he can not only just do his voice, but he can think of 30 jokes in that comedian's voice, and that's funnier than that comedian, which is great. And that's just you entertaining us. So then that's why it's so easy for you to do stand-up. Not easy, of course, it's hard, but relatively.
Yeah, it's a curse, no? That's another thing that a lot of people don't realize that I did a lot of theater work. And
yeah.
I mean, so did you. And people think like, oh, you guys can just move around on stage. Oh, you are this person, Naveen. It's like, no, Naveen does theater. He stays in character, even if he doesn't admit it. On all of this took work, but unfortunately, we do want to make it look simple and easy, but at the same time, we don't want to be taken for granted also.
I mean, that's the biggest lag. Like, you know, when you do a stand-up joke, immediate. When you put up a stand-up video, sometimes you get the laugh when the video comes out.
Yeah.
But when you act in a web series, it takes 1 year before you know whether people are laughing at the joke or not.
So, that's why stand-up is so fulfilling because the turnaround period is so fast.
Yeah.
You write it, you perform it, and then you record it and it's uploaded. While when you do a web series or a fiction show,
it's like years and it's
months
such
of writing, shooting, editing, and then finally it's out and you hate it because you've seen it so many times.
Yeah.
There's no joy, really.
Full perspective. I mean, people are watching whatever we've made from Starboys, Push Power Lee, BLF, everything. We have no idea if this is good. Till it goes out and the audience tells us that it's good. Or you screen it to your friends and you still don't trust your friends. Yeah. Also, your friends are really critical. So, if they say it's shit, it's probably
your,
not
your
as shit.
Your friends are very critical.
Yeah, I know.
You're very so high standard friends.
So I'm glad when you guys watch the shit and then you tag us and shit like that. You know, do it. Because, you know, when we watch a movie or a show,
yeah.
we don't go out of our way to tell. Very rarely do we go out of our way to say, hey, good job. Now, that's how many people are watching the stuff we make, and only this much are letting us know.
Yeah.
So it's important that you do it.
That's true, man. It's,
we need to know that we're going down the right path sometimes. We're not looking for validation, but it's important.
During the first episode, I said that so few people tell us that something's nice. So
yeah.
And a lot of people commented, and I know these were like people who don't comment usually, because the comments had perfect grammar and spacing.
Yeah.
And I'm like, where are you guys? Like, we need more of you.
Everyone's.
I'm also guilty. Like, I watched that VFX guys react.
Yeah.
I've seen all the videos. I've never left one comment.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So it's okay. We're not saying you have to, but once in a while, go out of your way. Like, especially if I see a movie that I know is not going to get appreciated, I'm like, I better talk about this because this fucking underrated. A lot of people tweet when they feel like it's going to be underrated.
Yeah.
That's another way.
In India, you only have underrated and overrated. There's no middle ground.
Yeah.
Kanan and I were talking about how Kanan was like, I was underrated and then I became overrated. I miss just being rated.
Yeah.
Yeah. Last question. We have come to the end of our show. Is a question we get a lot, and I think most people are asking it don't fully understand what they're asking. Rohini Sharma, it's not about you, Rohini, it's something in general. I want to ask you if you've ever been through an existential crisis and got existential anxiety. I've been having existential anxiety for a while, and now when people are around don't really understand it. What do you suggest I should do to cope? To be honest, I think most women get existential crisis because women are usually more well-read. Like if you see 5-year-olds or 8-year-olds, you see like little girls going in the corner and reading books, and you see the 8-year-old boy running around fucking breaking shit. And I think by the time women reach 20s, they have read like a bunch of shit. They've done gender studies. They've read literature. They talk to other people. Existential knowledge is there, where guys are still being like, man, I need to dress better. Like that's the self-awareness. So existential crisis was a big phase of my life 3 years ago.
Hmm.
It was horrible because also I'm very privileged. Like most of what I wanted, I got. And I was just like, now what?
Yeah, that crisis came early in your life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But also it is a very privileged thing. If you, every time you have an existential crisis, start a project. It'll go away.
It'll go away.
Yeah.
I when I do too little is when
that's
I start
when you get it,
asking questions. And I went through that phase, and it was exactly when I put everything else aside and I was like, I will only do stand-up now. And I suddenly had a lot of time on my hands.
Yeah.
And that's when I started freaking out about shit and about life. And that's a scary phase to go through.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you think that this is the first time you're going through an existential crisis, but you've gone through varying levels of it probably in different parts of your life. Like when I was going through it, I was like, holy shit, man. I thought I was immune to this shit. Why is it hitting me now? And then I realized, wait a minute. When I was a kid, I had some sort of crisis of who am I? Where do I fit in this circle?
Yeah.
And that started coming back to me. I'm like, I felt this kind of anxiety when in social groups. And you feel it and then you figure it out and you sail through life a little bit. You get into a new scenario. At least I mean, maybe there's super confident people who go through life just smashing, but I don't think even they don't have existential crisis. So I realized, well, it hits you every once in a while. And when you come out of it, you're going to be like, now I see the pattern. This is going to happen. And of course, it's going to happen to you again later in life when you suddenly have time to think about it maybe. And so when you're in the middle of an existential crisis, just like a fucking storm, you know that it's going
to
end.
That's so true. Nice to have that feeling. Just a few days ago, I was in the kitchen and I was having a bad day.
Yeah.
Nothing was going right. And then suddenly it hit me like, hey, it's one of those days.
Yeah.
It'll go away. And then I felt already better. Existential crisis happens when you think you're not going to escape it, but it's literally a day or two or a week. And again, like, it's people underestimate a routine. It's a blessing to have a routine.
Yeah.
When you have shit to do, why do you think older people who are like worked all their lives and retired have gardens or start knitting? Because your brain is a piece of shit and it needs, it's so much power. It's like having a horse in your house. And once you retire, the horse is going to destroy your house. This is a John Mulaney joke. The horse in the hospital, which is Trump. And That's the thing. Your brain, please respect your brain. Like, you need to give it something to do. And
keep moving forward. I think the only thing I realized that I learned when I came out of that is as long as you're moving forward in some way, you gotta.
It's like a stream. Yeah. It's always gonna go forward. Either you could just let it destroy the whole village, or you bring productive blocks and redirect it so that it goes into farming or into
exactly. It's not gonna stop.
It's not gonna stop.
An old uncle I was talking to. He,
which Naveen does a lot, by the way.
I get a lot of advice from old uncles.
He either talks to uncles or shouts.
He's this uncle, the uncle we stayed with in Kerala, right? So I visited him several times and I kind of...
He's a monk.
...look up to his chillness. And he was in a really good mood the last time I went to meet him.
Yeah.
And he was like, man, you know, when I was younger, I used to worry. When I would lose a job, I would worry. And then I realized that everything... works out for the best. So when I was meant to lose that job and go into something else, so he said, so I stopped worrying. I'm like, what do you mean you stop worrying? Isn't it important to worry a little bit so that gives you an idea of what to do next? Yeah. And he's like, no, you don't have to do that. Just don't worry. So when you're going through an existential crisis, and it's easy for me to say, I'm sure the next existential crisis I go through, I'm going to fucking worry.
Yeah.
I just have to write it down somewhere and let myself know.
Which is you accepting that your brain is a piece of shit. And it has to be reminded.
It's a dick sometimes.
Yeah. You have to respect how powerful your brain is and how also forgetful it is. So writing it down is...
the solution. So write it down. So like the other day, my friends and I were talking about... My friends who all have jobs now in law places. They were like, man, wasn't life simpler those days? What the fucking work and this and that? And I was like, Macha, you remember when exams would come along? This is in law school. Exams would come along. We would all call each other for 2-3 days straight and fucking freak out. Every time the exams would come around, that wasn't easy. And they were like, oh, yeah. I remember you'd call me and see how much I studied. Now
everything
and we were adults.
Is great in retrospect.
Yeah, so go through the crisis. Just know that it'll end. Just don't know when. But find yourself something to do.
Yeah. And that brings us to the end of this episode. I have the lovely Naveen Richard, who is also I live with him. So if you want to listen to this episode, you can listen to it on Spotify, Apple or Google or Stitcher or anywhere. You can also watch the video. The video is better because you can see our faces and shit.
You can see those faces. Well, it was nice talking to you. I'll see you.
Thanks, Naveen. Yeah, I'll see you. We'll have lunch now together. And also, if anyone complains about anything in this episode in terms of production quality, I will take this fist and shove it up your anus
far
inside. I can't actually. I'll get corona. It's pressed through anus, right?
Only butt to butt.
Butt to butt, yeah.
Only butt to butt. This is not scientifically proven. Don't say we're spreading false information. It's not a butt to butt.
No, I'm pretty confident that if I had corona and I shoved my hand in someone's anus, they would get it.
They wouldn't get it?
They would get it.
Yeah, it is an orifice. Your butt is an orifice.
It's like a great word, man. Such a great nose. Word, no, orifice.
I don't like saying butthole.
It sounds like an Egyptian god.
Your bottom orifice.
The orifice.
The official orifice is your butthole.
Shouldn't be unleashed. So again, thank you for listening and please ask your questions in the comments below and thank you for sending questions.
And watch all the shit we made before.
Oh yes, things you can watch during this quarantine period is Naveen Special, which is on Prime Video. You can watch Star Boys, which is a show that Naveen and I wrote and made 3 years ago.
And okay, you know, they say, oh, in retrospect, everything was fun.
Yeah.
But writing that show was fun.
It was a lot of
making
fun.
Making it, as I'm sure, was a bitch for
it
you.
It was a bitch, yeah, for me because I produced it. So I had to sit on the edits.
See, we just think you should watch some shit. We're not going to praise our own shit. Watch some shit. The shit we make is light and it will make you forget about shit.
I know no one will believe this, but we wrote Star Boys when we were not stoned. And I don't smoke up. I'm not saying that Naveen does. But I clearly don't. And but if you are stoned and you love smoking up, it's the best show you can ever watch. So go watch Star Boys right now and tell me in the comments if you did. I'm following the analytics of the video. So I know if you're lying to me.
Yeah, man. Yeah, it's just lighthearted show.
Okay, bye.
All right.